Okay, so I was in the process of speaking about the etale cohomology of diamonds. So let's try to remind ourselves a little bit where we are. So we were always working with this test category that's called perf, which was a category of perfectoid spaces of characteristic p. And this had two topologies. It has a proetale topology. Which was generated by open covers. And co-filtered inverse limits. Of surjective etale maps of phenoids. And then there was another topology called the V topology, where we allowed many more covers. So again, that's generated by open covers and also ejective maps of affinoids. Okay, and then let me bring this back on the board. We had the definition that a diamond is a quotient, is a proetale sheaf on perf. Oh no, let's call it Y actually. Such that Y can be written as X mod R, where X is a perfectoid space, or the sheaf represented by a perfectoid space. And R in X times X is a proetale equivalence relation. Okay, and there was a theorem that all diamonds are V-sheaves. And in fact, many many things generalize to all, and maybe there's a set theoretic condition of being small V-sheaves. Okay, and so in particular, if X is a small V-sheaf, and so lambda again will be a ring, a coefficient ring, such that. And last time I was making some comments about statements which are true more generally. But at least from today on, everything that is new today, it will really be necessary to assume that n lambda is 0 for some n which is not divisible by p. Okay, so if X is such a small V-sheaf, then we have the derived category of lambda modules on X, by which I mean you take the V side of X, which is just all small V sheaves mapping to X. I'm ignoring set theoretic issues. And I'm looking at lambda modules on Z, takes the derived category of Z. And in there, there was a certain subcategory that I called the etale X lambda, which is essentially characterized by the property that whenever I pull back to a perfectoid space, it comes from the etale derived. I mean, okay, let me first write this and then say what's true. So the thing to know about these categories is that containment in the subcategories can be checked relocally. And if X is a perfectoid space, respectively and totally, strictly totally disconnected. So strictly totally disconnected guys were these things which were essentially just profinite sets of points. And we were using a little often that anything can be covered by a profinite set of points. Then this d plus ed was just the d plus of the etale side of x, which can then be defined lambda. And if you want the statement to be true for the unbounded category, you need this extra assumption. You can get it in slightly more general settings if there is some bound on the cohomological dimension of X.
In the strictly totally disconnected, there is a bound on the cohomological dimension or not?
Yes, the cohomological dimension is zero. Like for anything which is any separated etale quasi-compact map, say, to a strictly totally disconnected guy is again strictly totally disconnected. And if you have something strictly totally disconnected, then there's no higher cohomology at all.
Ah, just in the separated quasi-compact, this is enough.
Right, but this is the basis for the topology. So. Okay. Okay, so these are the objects we care about, and actually the one we care most about is this guy. So. Okay, so let's talk about the six operations. So let me start with some simple ones. So first of all, there is some tensor product. Well, that's a priori maybe defined on dx lambda, oh, just the usual thing we always have. And it respects this d at. And so you get it there. Let me say what I do for the R-HOM. If you take this, then this does not respect. This guy. But you can somehow reflect it back. So this inclusion has an adjoint. Mm-hmm. Which in some cases, if you're a perfectoid space and lines a D plus or so, you can sometimes more explicitly say what this really means. So this is actually a little bit tricky to understand what this means.
Is it a left or right object?
It is a right adjoint. So this inclusion preserves all co-limits. And then, well, you can upgrade the whole situation to infinity categories, and then it follows from Lurie's infinity categorical joint functor theorem that there must be an adjoint. OK, so if f from y to x is a map of small v sheaves, then the pullback preserves the viet. It commutes with tensor products. Yeah. Okay. And so you also want to push forward. If f is QCQS, then the RF Lower star from dy lambda to dx lambda, it respects the d plus etale and induces. Such a map. And under an assumption of bounded cohomological dimension, also on the unbounded derived categories. So this defines such an operation, RF lower star, for QCQS morphisms. But I wanted this such an operation more generally. So for a general F, I can define the operation on this unbounded etale derived category as a right adjoint of F upper star.
The cohomological dimension is for the RF lower star or for both x and y?
No, for RF lower star. Oh. So I think it's literally enough to assume that whenever you have an etale sheaf on y, then if I apply this RF lower star, then RIF lower star is equal to 0 for sufficiently large. So then there is this caution that this is not compatible. So equivalently, as You can also embed the derived category for Y into this full derived category of V-sheaves. Then there is an RF, let's call it V-law star, defined on the level of sites here. But this may not end in this D-at, and then you can just reflect back. When F is QCQS, I recover it on the D plus etale, and on the bounded cohomology I mentioned also on the D8 in the full one. But so in the cases of overlap, it's the same thing. But in more general cases, that's actually that is the operation I want to consider. Okay. Okay. So this takes care of four of the operations, and then there are two more. F Lorsch R. The RF lower shriek and RF upper shriek. And at the end of the last lecture, I discussed a little bit the push forward with compact supports. And so let's remind ourselves about this. So let's talk about these functors. So for this, I need to talk about compactifications again. So let me let's remind ourselves how this went. So there was this funny thing that for p-adic spaces, there's this canonical compactifications. It's canonical compactification, which is somehow slightly weird, so which only adds a few higher rank points. So if f from y to x is a separated map of V-sheaves, small, well, I guess I can do this in general. then I can do the compactification of f over x, f bar over x. Which goes from a space called y bar over x to x. Which is given by the functor which takes some spar r plus and in some sense forgets the information of the r plus. Or at least it forgets all the information of r plus as regards y, but keeps it for x as we still want something which lives over x. So it's a thing which maps this to the y of r, r circ, where your points that's nonsense. This way, okay. So, for example, if you want to map a, but I need to assume that this is totally disconnected. If you want to map some point kk plus to it, then you only need to map the rank one point, the maximal generalization to y, and maybe the the full point, the higher rank point to x. So these kinds of things you parameterize here, they are actually some of the kind of diagrams you would draw on the evaluative criterion of properness. And so we have this thing, and then f is compactifiable. If f is separated. And so there's always a total a natural map from J, an injective map into this compactification. And you ask that this is an open inversion. So let's just briefly discuss one example again. So if we have Y, which is the p-adic spectrum of this guy mapping to X, which is bar K, OK. So this is a ball, a closed unit disk. But it's not quite closed as an p-adic space. It's not yet proper. And so you include one higher rank point. So then y bar over x. Is this thing. And then I take ok plus a maximal ideal times gp infinity. On the other hand, if Y is the A1 over K as an p-adic space mapping to X, which is still. So this is the first example. And the second example, if you have this guy, then actually Y bar over X is just equal to Y. And so this sounds strange, because you wouldn't think that the A1 should be proper. You would want to compactify it into a P1, maybe. But that's not what happens. And the reason is that actually, if you consider the A1 as an p-adic space, then it's this increasing union of larger and larger disks. A1 is a union of increasing disks. And the kind of universal compactification of each disk sits inside the next disk. And so so it's what's called partially proper.
But see, the compact supported cohomology of A1, you want it to be.
Yes, that's why there will be a quasi-compacity condition in a second. Okay. So you can. So let's see how we define compactly supported cohomology.
This partially proper the same as this compactification. Does it add anything?
Right. Partially proper is actually, well, there's a more geometric definition for p-adic spaces. But one way to say it in our setup is that this map J is just an isomorphism. So it's equivalent to saying that you have some kind of variative criterion that whenever you have a map from spar R circ to Y, and one, when you draw such a diagram, it's an unique map here. It's related to this one statement, this one variative criterion of properness that I stated last time. Okay, so this brings us to the following definition slash theorem. So let's assume that f from y to x is a quasi-compact. So this disallows this A1 example here for the moment, because this is increasing union of disks. Quasi-compact morphism of V-sheaves, small V-sheaves. Sorry, compactifiable, I need to add. Okay, so then we're in the situation where we have y, which embeds yij into this compactification, which sits over x, this is f. And so then this map is actually open by assumption, and this map is proper according to the definition of properness I gave last time. And so then, if I look at RF lower shriek, which I define to be the usual thing, you push forward after you extend by zero. So this is a map from dy lambda to dx lambda. This preserves the d plus etale. So this induces and also a map on the full derived categories. If RF lower shriek has bounded cohomological dimension. And is compatible with base composition and base change. So a composite compatible a composite of compactifiable morphisms is again compactifiable as is a base change.
So somehow the formation of white bar slash x is and how strictly compatible
with composition? Okay, so let me explain how, what happens. So if I have z to y to x, then this has a compactification over x. This has a compactification over y.
This You define it.
Yeah, yeah, yeah. And then this also has a compactification over x. And this little diagram here is a Cartesian diagram.
So induces means just by restriction without any adjoint.
Right. I mean, yes. So it really, if you apply this to something, the d plus etale, it really maps, applies this function, it really lies in the subcategory. One funny thing about the situation is that you could already ask this compatibility with composition without passing to the d etale. So let me actually write this down. And then I believe it's not true. So there are maybe two remarks about this, which are related. So well, no, maybe this one. So we could ask, so let's consider the situation z to y to x, f and g, f, g as above. So quasi-compact, compactifiable. Then you could ask the question, is if I first apply G and then F, is it the same thing as this thing on the four guys? Okay, and I should one day sit down and actually found a counterexample to this, but I believe it's not true. And so you actually need to restrict to this d etale to make this true. So there is a natural map in one direction, which I'm not able to figure out right now. And well, you can show that there's an equivalence if you plug in such a guy, such a diet guy in this etale thing. But it might fail in general. And so for this reason, it's actually that's the main reason that it's necessary to really work with this d etale and not something more general. So.
But at least there is a map in one direction.
There's a map in one direction, yes.
And on D plus also it should fail.
Even on D plus, yeah. And I think even on this, there was this other guy that I didn't recall this time. So I think even on this category, it should fail. OK, so this way we get this RF lower shriek. OK, so there's another unrelated remark. So there's another thing if this map is not quasi-compact. So then we can do the following. So if F is compactifiable, maybe not quasi-compact. But it is representable in locally spatial diamonds. meaning that for all x prime mapping to x, where x prime is a locally spatial diamond, y times x, x prime is a locally spatial diamond. then one can define RF lower shriek as a direct limit. And let me allow to be a little bit vague here. Of all u and y, which are quasi-compact open, quasi-compact over x open. Say if the base is locally spatial. In general, by descent. Okay, so the logic is a little intricate here. I just want to say you can extend it, and the essential thing is that you just define it as a direct limit of the RF lower shrieks for all open subsets, quasi-compact open subsets, and then take a direct limit. This only works if you have enough quasi-compact open subsets. This is this condition of being locally spatial, essentially. And so If everything inside Y and X were such locally spatial diamonds, then this formula I would have written would be OK. In general, it's enough to assume that the map is somehow locally spatial, in which case you just reduce to the previous case by descent. It's not the most critical thing. All right, so so this gives us five of the six functors, and we need to find the last one. Also, there's also a projection formula. So. I should say this. Let's say it's a quasi-compact compactifiable. Map of small V-sheaves then. RL floor shriek of A tensor lambda. Yeah, so once you have the projection formula, you can essentially and space change theorems, you can essentially formally get a Künneth formula. Okay, so of course the last functor, RF upper shriek, wants to be defined as the right adjoint to RF lower shriek. But to make this work, you really need to be in the setup where RF lower shriek is defined on the full derived category. And so we have this assumption there of bounded cohomological dimension. And so I actually want to talk a little bit about dimensions for this reason.
So this is holding on the what? On which A and B?
A, B are in the D. So A is in D etale Y lambda. B is in D etale X lambda. Sorry. And I might have to assume some bounded cohomological dimension again. Where is this? Here. Where is this? Here. Okay, so it holds for this under if something happens that I didn't define yet. If some, sorry, if some dimension of S is finite, which brings me to dimensions. It's some kind of transcendence degree dimension, geometric so this G stands for geometrics, this Tritt stands for transcendence degree, and this DIM stands for dimension. We will come to it. I'm sorry, maybe I was assuming for this one other little thing. Yeah, representable. Well, I can remove this and say it's representable in locally spatial diamonds. And this dimension is finite. And the tricky thing with the projection formula is that this RF lower streak is usually better defined on the D plus, whereas this derived tensor product goes very unbounded to the left, and you have to be a little careful a bit about this. Okay. I need to talk about dimensions. So there are the following notions of dimensions. So so the first thing we need is the Krull dimension. If X is a locally spectral space, then the Krull dimension of X is, it's a supremum of all n such that there exists a chain of specializations x naught, x1, up to xn. Where specialization means that one is contained in the closure of the other. Maybe put this here. If f from y to x is a map, is a spectral map of locally spectral spaces, I guess in principle one could, well, no, let's assume this. Locally spectral spaces. Then I define the dimension of F to be the supremum of the dimensions. Now, by the way, where does this live? This is either a non-negative integer. It could be infinite, but it could also be minus infinite. That's if F X is empty. Then the dimension of F is the supremum over all x and x of the dimension of the preimage. And again, this is either a non-negative integer or infinite or minus infinite. But this only happens if y is empty.
Are there notions of dimension functions?
Are there notions of dimension functions? Well, so far we're here in the completely abstract setup. One could ask this for diamonds. Not really, I'm afraid. So there is this issue that the locally, the usual closed immersions that one would want to look at, like a point mapping into a closed unit disk, they are actually not so well behaved in some ways in this world of p-adic spaces, because the complement of this map is a non-quasi-compact open subset, which means that this map has non-constructible image, which means, say, that the skyscraper sheaf support at this point is not constructible. It also, a related fact is that there is no specialization of a point of the complement into this closed point, as you know for schemes. And so actually, so if you want to, say, define the co-dimension of this point, you can't really define it directly on the spectral space, because the spectral space actually doesn't see that there is any, that they are connected in any way, really. I mean, a bit tricky. All right, so anyway, I mean, these notions exist. And then there is another thing that I need. That let's assume we have K contained in L, an extension of complete non-Archimedean fields. Then I define the kind of continuous transcendence degree. There might be a C. So these names are essentially due to Huber of this dim tr of L over K to be the minimum of the set of all n such that exists some L prime in L, a dense subfield. Containing K, such that the transcendence degree of L over K, L prime over K is equal to N.
Yeah, but it is difficult to get good behavior under composition of this because you get only one.
Right, so this is actually a slightly tricky definition. So there's the following very basic questions that I don't know the answer to. So I mean, what is true is that, okay, let me make a remark. So if K is contained in L is contained in M, then there is a sub-additivity. So this transcendence degree for M over K is at most the sum of the transcendence degree here plus the transcendence degree, this continuous transcendence degree. Sorry, I didn't want to call this. Sorry. I wanted to call this the continuous transcendence degree. Sorry. And then when I go to morphisms, I want to call it the dimension of the morphism, but sorry. okay, so this is not so hard to see. But additivity may fail, equality may fail, and equality may fail for good reasons. So if say if K is something like this guy, so some complete algebraically closed field of characteristic P, and M is algebraically closed and of transcendent of this transcendence degree equal to 1. Then there exist some. So you would think that, I mean, in algebraic geometry, or for usual fields, if you have two algebraically closed fields, one is of transcendence degree one over the other, then there are no algebraically closed fields in between them. But this fails in this setting. So then there exists some K contained in L contained in M, both proper, where L is again algebraically closed and transcendence degree equal to 1.
Over each of them?
Well, over K. But then a fortiori also for M over L. I mean, if this was less than 1, namely 0, then this would mean that there is a dense subfield which is algebraic over the base. But if this is already algebraically closed, there can't be further algebraic elements. Thus, this would have to be dense. But if these are both complete, then this would have to be an equality. But it's not an inequality, and so this has to be actually equal to 1.
And can it be also in characteristic 0?
I think this can't happen in characteristic 0. So there's a paper of Martignon and Reversa which discusses this problem. One funny thing to note about this paper from Martignon and Reversa, which is, I think, from the 80s, early 80s, is that they already defined the notion of a perfectoid field in this paper. They called it a hyperperfect field.
Science has progressed.
All right. So additivity may fail. You could at least ask whether there's some monotonicity. And even this I don't know. Yeah. Question. If you have the situation K contained in L contained in M, is it true that this continuous transcendence degree for L over K is at least bounded by the one for M over K? Let me just note that the similar question for M over L is actually true. And follows immediately different from the definition. But for this thing, it's not so clear because here you would have some dense subfield of M, which has some small transcendence degree, but this dense subfield has no reason to intersect L in any way. So it's not clear how to find a dense subfield of L. So even in the case where M is the algebraic closure of L, I don't know this. So, okay. So in the absence of knowledge of this, of the answer, I define a slightly different notion. sorry. It's called geometric. To be what you get for the corresponding extension of algebraically closed complete fields.
And you can eliminate for K this operation.
You can eliminate for K. I mean, it's the same as. And it's always less or equal to the one for L. That's by sub-additivity. It's less or equal to this plus the corresponding thing for the algebraic closure over L, but that is transcendence degree 0. All right. This is all stupid, but. But I mean, I think it's an interesting question, just in general, to try to establish some good theory of transcendence degree for these non-Archimedean fields and see what properties one can establish and which fail. So for example, this counterexample is also interesting.
Use this new notion to cure the problem of this spontaneity.
No, even then I can't answer monotonicity, but. Yeah. The problem I have is that if I have a diamond, then it doesn't have a well-defined residue field, because, but it has a well-defined algebraic closure of its residue field. And so I need a notion of this transcendence degree which only depends on the algebraic closure. Okay. So so here's a basic proposition. Let's say that. Let's assume you have a quasi-separated diamond. Such that the underlying topological space is a point. So what are the diamonds with a small quasi-separation hypothesis whose topological space is just a point? We can understand those. Namely, then X is of the form spa COC modulo the action of G for some unique but up to non-unique isomorphism as usual, complete algebraically closed field C. With a continuous and faithful action of a profinite group G. Which you would like to, so you would like to think of C as a algebraically closed residue field, the completion of the algebraic closure of the residue field, and as G as the Galois group of this point. But G may not be the Galois group of any actual field, it's just something which acts. Okay. I mean, so conversely, whenever you have such data of such a complete algebraically closed field C of characteristic P with such a continuous and faithful action of a profinite group G, you can define such a quasi-separated diamond here whose space is a point. So you can understand the structure of points of adic spaces. And so I can make the following definition.
So in general, the field of invariance can be very small.
The field of invariance might just be FP or something like this. So you might have the case that if you take this, if you take spa QP and then take its diamond, then what you get is somehow this field modulo the Galois group of QP. But if you take the invariance in here, you just get FP. And so there's not any actual field in the business here. Anyway, so before the break, let me finish by giving this kind of transcendence degree dimension. So let's say that f from y to x say it's a map of locally special diamonds. This G stands for geometric. This tr stands for transcendence. And dim stands for dimension, of course. Is the supremum over all y mapping to x of the this kind of geometric transcendence degree. Well, which is actually the same thing as this continuous guy because I'm doing algebraically closed guys here. Of C of y over C of x. And I can see some maximal points. Where Well, I mean, it's equal to the true because we're only doing geometric guys. I just wanted to stress that even in the case where these were perfectoid spaces, I'm actually doing something different by passing to this algebraic closed guys. Where, say, if I this is the localization of x at x. And similarly for. The definition of C of Y is similar. C of x is defined up to isomorphism, but I mean, I'm only computing numbers, and these numbers are in the end independent.
So the map of C of x to C of y is still well defined up to actions of some groups.
Right.
They don't change the. Okay.
Okay, let's have a break now for 15 minutes. Well, the localization of a spectral. In general, if you have a spectral space and you have a point in it, then there's the notion of the localization of the spectral space at this point, which is just a set of all generalizations of this point. But if you have maximal points, then there are no further generalizations.
Oh, I didn't see maximal. Okay.
Well, I mean, if you would want to define such a completed residue field as a non-maximal point, it would be the same as at the maximal generalization. And so it's not really not much is lost by assuming these are maximal to start with. Okay, so. Another basic proposition is that, so before the break, I defined this notion of this transcendence dimension for a morphism. And the basic fact is that the dimension of F, considered just as a map of spectral spaces, is bounded by this geometric transcendence dimension. Let me just sketch it. So if x is a maximal point, if you look at the closure of x, then this always embeds into the Tsarisky-Riemann space for.
It's the wrong order of the locals. What did you define as the dim F? The dim of the fibers. Oh, okay.
Right. What? I'm trying to concentrate here, okay? always in Tsarisky-Riemann space, where kappa of x is you take the residue field of C of x, this completed residue field. And then actually there you can take the gx invariance and get a reasonable field, because there the action is actually continuous for the discrete topology, and then you're in a better shape. sorry, if x is a maximal point, and say, let's assume for the moment that x is separated. So there is a relation between the specializations of points you see here and the Tsarisky-Riemann space of some fields. And and so this bounds essentially the dimension, well, in this case, maybe of x, by the dimension of these residue fields. And so that's how you get this. So this bounds the cold dimension in terms of transcendence degree of this thing over FP. And this is some kind of relative version of this observation. Okay, so we have this, and then another proposition is the following. Let's say that X is a spatial diamond. And F is a sheaf on its etale side. Then the etale cohomology of F is 0 for any I which is larger than the dimension of X, plus the supremum over all X and X maximal of the cohomological dimension. Let's assume it's an L torsion sheaf, L not equal to P. Well, I think it's not even necessary. The L cohomological dimension of GX. Okay, so you can bound the cohomology dimension of the etale side in terms of just the Kroll dimension and the somehow Galois cohomological dimension of these points. Let me sketch this. you look at there's a map from the etale side to the just the side of the underlying topological space. Let's call this lambda. It comes down to two things. The first to check that if you push forward f under this map, then this is 0 for I bigger than the supremum over the L cohomological dimensions of these points. And that's for this, you just observe that the fibers are given by GX cohomology. At least at maximal points, at non-maximal points, you need a small extra argument, but it works. And on the other hand, the cohomological dimension of X as a topological space is bounded by the dimension of X. And this is actually a theorem of Scholze from 1992. So this holds for any spectral space. Of course, everybody knows the theorem of Grothendieck, that if you have an Assyrian topological space, then the cohomological dimension is bounded by the Kroll dimension. but actually, there's an unnecessary Assyrian hypothesis, so this is always true. Okay, so these are the ingredients. And so this tells us why The Kroll dimension is relevant to the picture, but now we need to unbound the cohomological dimensions of these residue fields here. And for this, this business of transcendence degrees will be important. So let's say we're in the following situation. Say it's a spatial diamond over some sparse COC. And so by F, I want to denote this map from X to sparse UOC. Then if I look at the supremum over all X and X of the cohomological dimension of this profinite group GX, then it's bounded by this geometric transcendence degree dimension. If L is not equal to P. So this relates, okay, let me say what this comes down to. So sketch. This reduces to if C prime over C is some other algebraically closed complete field, and G is a profinite group, acting continuously and faithfully on C prime, but over C, I mean, with trivial action on C. Then we need to bound the cohomological dimension of G, which wants to be this Galois group, by the transcendence degree, this continuous transcendence degree of C prime over C. And so, of course, such a bound is well known if G was an actual Galois group of a field over C. But this is just some profinite group, which a priori has nothing to do with any field. But you can still make enough of Galois theory work. So this is well-known Galois theory. If G were a Galois group. In this case, he wouldn't need an assumption on L, right? So it might be true that this, well, yes, actually, I think it might be true that this is also true if L is equal to P, but I don't know how to prove this. So what turns out to be true is that you can, up to some pro P group, you can essentially control what G can be. So you can still define some P in I and in G. So where is this some kind of inertia? This is some kind of wild inertia. Where this is pro P. this can be, this quotient I mod P is somehow bounded by value groups. this bounded by so I mean C prime and C have their they non-Archimedean fields, so they have value groups in the real numbers. And this so the one for C prime might be bigger than for C, and this is bounded in terms of the difference you see on value groups. And this is bounded by the transcendence degree of residue fields. So this G mod I. Kappa prime over kappa. And then there is a general theorem in Bohr by Key that relates the transcendence degree on residue fields, the value groups, and the transcendence degrees of the fields themselves. And so you finish using this inequality. But I don't see a priori any way of controlling what this wild inertia here looks like. It might be really wild now.
Okay. I think it's wrong for L equal to P because it will look like Gelfand-Fuchs cohomology of Lie algebra vector fields with maybe quadratic bound.
Okay.
Yeah, so it's kind of natural, kind of zero cryptistic analogy. Consider the algebra formal vector field.
Yeah. And this can act on such a non-Archimedean field, you say?
Yeah, it should be the same. Yeah, it should be more or less the same, yeah, I suppose.
Okay, maybe we can discuss this after. Yeah. Great. So finally, I can somehow state what all of this discussion is leading to. So let's say f from y to x is a compactifiable map of small V-sheaves. Which is representable in locally spatial diamonds. Also, by the way, I mean, this discussion also tells you why I'm making two assumptions throughout. One is that I assume that my diamonds are spatial, so that the underlying topological space is spectral, so that I can apply this theorem of Scheiderer bounding the cohomological dimension. And the other is that I assume that they are diamonds, which was this condition about points. And this condition about points comes up somehow through this proposition that if you have these maps from algebraically closed fields into them, which are proetale, then you can control what these points look like. Okay. So that's why this notion of a maybe locally spatial diamond is really the setup I want to work in. All right, so then if A is in D less or equal to N, Y lambda, then RF lower shrink of A lies in D less or equal to N plus 3 times F. You would expect 2 there. It might be true with 2. My proof doesn't give it. Let me tell you why. What's the technical issue that makes a 3 appear? So the So if you have y to x, a map of spatial diamonds, say, even, a compactifiable map of spatial diamonds. I do not know whether the compactification y bar over x is again spatial. So it is a diamond. It's quasi-compact, separated. But I don't know how to get enough quasi-compact open subsets of this guy. So it's not true that if I take a quasi-compact open subset of y and then compactify it, it will be a quasi-compact open subset of this compactification, just because some of the, again, the closure, it's automatically closed because you were taking some compactification. And so there is no obvious way of producing any quasi-compact open subsets in here. And so this means that I cannot actually apply this kind of proposition there, which apply to spatial diamonds, to this compactification, and then you need to work around this, and then there is a workaround, but I don't want to go into this. But in any case, it shows that if your system of F is finite, then R of lower shriek has finite cohomological dimension. And so definition, let F be such a guy, so let F from Y to X be compactifiable, representable in locally spatial diamonds. Such that the this thing is finite. Then finally we can define R of upper shriek from D to Y fixed Y is a right adjoint. Of R of lower shriek, which in this case is defined on the full derived category. And in some sense, this is a theorem, because implicitly claimed there is that there is such a right adjoint. So why is there a right adjoint? You use that R of lower shriek commutes with all direct sums. In particular, infinite direct sums. And the infinity categorical adjoint functor theorem. For this, you have to briefly update this functor to a functor of infinity categories and then apply it. But
can one use the classical construction with Godemore resolutions?
Can one use the classical construction with Godemore resolutions? I never learned the Godemore resolutions. sorry. I would believe that if these things are actually locally spatial diamonds, then this should be okay, but I mean, somehow you need to be in the setup where this guy I call d-ed is actually the derived category of etale sheaves on something. I think, to apply this Kottwitz thing. No, I don't know. So, and so, which would need, and so then I would need to make very strong assumptions on X. Not just relatively, but somehow absolutely, and I don't want to put absolute restrictions on X. And so.
Okay, no, but you can replace X by a simplicial system of special.
Yeah. Well, I think once you pass the simplicial thing, it's, I mean, you're not so far from just doing. Anyway, it exists. Okay, and so okay, so that's purely abstract right now, and so we want to make this functor explicit in some cases, and so in particular there should be some kind of smooth morphisms for which RF upper shriek is essentially just given by pullback twisted by something. And then you can wonder what's the right definition of smoothness is in our case. So, but you can also not do it and just define cohomological smoothness as being satisfies what you wanted to satisfy. So F, as in the definition, as in previous definition. Is L cohomologically smooth? So, as usual, L is not P. If the following happens, and essentially, you just want to say that this functor is given by pullback twisted with some invertible thing. But you need to say this not just for X, but for any base change. But actually, it slightly simplifies in that you only have to verify this for strictly totally disconnected guys. So the condition is the following. If for X prime to X, where X prime is strictly totally disconnected, factoid space. If I look at, let's call this map fx prime, it's a map from y times x, x prime to x prime. If shriek pullback under this map is equivalent to some L tensor fl. Star is functors from d etale x prime fl. So the condition is just that there is an equivalence of functors. Where L is, L is locally isomorphic to FL and some NZ, which may depend on where you are locally. So that's like the minimal requirement that you would want to put on a smooth morphism. So a smooth, if you have a smooth morphism, it should be, any pullback should be smooth. So in particular, all these fx primes should be smooth. And if they are smooth, then it should be of this form. It doesn't matter, etale, v, it's all the same for this question. Okay, so that's the minimal thing you would want. And the good news is that if this minimal requirement is satisfied, then a few good properties follow. So So if it's cohomologically smooth, so in this definition of cohomological smoothness, I only used FL coefficients. But actually, things improve from there. So then for all L power torsion rings lambda, it is true that RF upper shriek is equivalent to something I call DF tensor. Well, maybe I say this more canonically. There is always a natural map from this kind of gadget to this guy as functors from D at x lambda to D at y lambda. So this natural map is then an equivalence. Note that this is also something that's even for if lambda is just FL, it's not part of the definition because a priori I only asked this after pullbacks to strictly totally disconnected bases. But it's already true on the base then. What else? And RF upper shriek lambda is etale locally isomorphic to lambda in degree n. And the formation of RF upper shriek commutes with any base change. Meaning, if I have y to x here, I have some x prime mapping to it. And I have some y prime, the fiber product. Let's call this f prime. And I have some map g tilde here. Then there is a natural transformation of functors from g tilde upper star rf lower shriek, rf upper shriek maps to RF prime upper shriek G upper star. This function is from this equivalent. So in particular, the dualizing complex commutes with any base change. So let's call this guy here df. So in particular, the dualizing complex for this map f prime is canonically isomorphic to the pullback of the dualizing complex for f. Note that this is also something that wasn't asked in the definition, that this sheaf L which appears there in this local equivalence is actually compatible with any base change. It follows from.
Does it suffice to prove to check this on one surjective?
Does it so? Yes. So if the base is already strictly totally disconnected, you might ask yourself whether it's enough to check this now just on x itself, not after any base change. And this is something I don't know. So you still need to check it for all further base changes to bigger algebraically closed fields somehow.
And can this n be made explicit?
What is this n that appears there? Good question. I don't know. So this n somehow gives you another weight. So you would expect that, for example, n is even. But I don't know this. For the affine space, it's just what you expect. OK, I will come to some examples in a second. OK, there is still some time left. OK, so what was the question? What do I wanted to say? I'm lost. What is this n? So this n somehow gives you another way to define the dimension of the smooth morphism. So it's somehow the degree shift in the dualizing complex. And I don't know how to relate this in general to these other dimensions I was discussing. So there is some fuzziness about dimensions right now in the theory that needs to be resolved. But anyway, so if you have such a cohomologically smooth morphism, then this essentially, the theorem essentially tells you that everything you would expect to be true in the usual formalism is true. So, but this doesn't tell you that there are any examples. So maybe let me just note this. I mean, so corollary is that you get a smooth space change. And Poincare duality for these guys. Okay. But this is completely abstract, so we need examples. What's good about this notion of cohomologically smooth morphism is that it has a lot of good stability properties. So let me first note these stability properties. So once you have some example, you get a lot of other examples. And then in the end, I will tell you one example, one base case. So composites of cohomologically smooth are there is a 2 out of 3 property. So if you have g from z to y, f from y to x, this is surjective. And if g and the composite are L cohomologically smooth, then f is L cohomologically smooth. So you can check whether you are L cohomologically smooth. You can check this L cohomologically locally. And I guess it's F composed with G. then this cohomological smoothness is V local on the target. It's the first point. Composites are. And then there's the following slightly funny operation. So assume we're in the following situation. If f from y to x is L cohomologically smooth, and g is some Propy group, or pro prime to L, but let's say pro p. Acting freely on y over x with trivial action on x. Then if I take the quotient by k from y mod k to x, then this is still cohomologically smooth. G. So recall that a lot of the examples were constructed by taking something more explicit and then quotienting out by some action of what's often a Propy group. And so this takes care of these quotients by Propy groups. If you take something smooth and quotient by a Propy group, it's still smooth. And then there's this one example that gets everything running. It's that if B is a V sheaf, which takes a which is some other closed unit ball, which takes R plus to R plus. Then the projection from B to the point is L cohomology this way. In other words, if I take spa of I can base change this to some non-Archimedean field. And then it's just this usual closed disk. And the n is 2, right? And so RF upper shriek of lambda is canonically isomorphic to lambda t twisted by 1 shifted by 2. And so, okay, so sketch. Well, the hardest part, the one where most input comes into, is of course the last part. And this uses pretty much everything from Huber's book, so it uses extensively. So the essential thing you need is you need a complete theory of Poincare duality for smooth curves over algebraically closed non-Archimedean fields. And but this is done by Huber. One thing to note is that here it's really important how I phrase the definition, that I only need to check something over these strictly totally disconnected bases. And then by some reduction arguments, I can actually get rid of this profinite set and just actually work over a point. And so in the end, everything is just reduced to the classical setup of a ball over a point. And then I can directly cite Huber's book. OK. Great. And so now starting with this one example and using all the stability properties, you can now verify that lots and lots of things are cohomologically smooth. So for example, you could take the A1 over CP and take the associated diamond. So then this lives over sparse CP diamond, which is just the etic spectrum of the tilt. How does one see that this is L cohomologically smooth? So this can be checked locally. So and this is an increasing union of balls, so reduced to, well, you could say it's an increasing union of balls, but you could also do something slightly different. And you can essentially reduce to the case of a torus, or if this, you could first reduce to the ball, but then this ball is covered by two copies of a torus. So where T is the set of all. The points are the set of all X, which are absolute value. And really T with CP. So here's the space. But then you, so actually T is a spar of CP. This guy. And so, as in the first lecture, you have this T infinity, where you adjoin all P prime roots of it. And then, well, first of all, T infinity flat it's the same thing for the tilde. And so this is actually open in the ball. It's just the subset of points where the absolute value of t is equal to 1. And so this implies that, maybe there should have also been a part 0. That etale implies it will come logically smooth. So this is cohomologically smooth. This is open in it. And so T infinity flat mapping to sparse CP flat is cohomologically smooth. But then you can recover T as a quotient. Let me finish this sort. But then, if I look at this torus over CP, and it passes the diamond, then this is this T infinity. Well, at some point I lost the subscript CP. The tilde modulo the action of ZP. Everything here over. And so now I use this funny statement 4. I hope this wasn't a sign. OK, so you use this, and then you conclude that this guy is cohomologically smooth. Let's do another example.
This shows that in general smooth adic spaces are.
Yeah, so in general you can use this to show that smooth adic spaces are cohomologically smooth. Because composites are, the products are also cohomologically smooth, so you get that affine spaces are cohomologically smooth, and then in general something smooth is Hall over an affine space, and then. And n is always twice the dimension, yeah. And right, so I wanted to do another example. So at one point I had this guy beat around plus mod fill 2, which had this extension, which was an extension between diamond of A1 over CP. So this is an extension of group diamonds. Well, I guess these examples are called Banach-Kolmé spaces over sparse CP diamond. And claim is it's smooth. Sorry, I mean, maybe I should say more precisely what I mean. So I have the speedrun plus mod fill 2. Well, it is a diamond. And this maps to sparse CP diamond. And I claim that this map here is well cohomologically smooth. Okay. And I was. This is really an example which doesn't come from usual geometry. It's not a smooth etic space or anything. And so it's really non-trivial to get your hands on this guy.
Is any group object cohomologically smooth?
Well, all these Banach-Kolmé spaces are cohomologically smooth. Well, any group object. I'm not sure I can talk about any group object. I mean. Yeah. I don't know what they are. No, that's true for any. I just want to consider the simplest example to explain how the arguments go. So this maps to the A1 over CP diamond. And we know this is smooth by the previous example. And so it's enough to prove that this map here is smooth. So it's enough that F is smooth. But now we use that this can be checked locally. V locally, and V locally, this has a splitting. And so once you fix the splitting, and so if you have a map space X mapping surjectively onto here, such that there's a splitting, then this relatively, this just decomposes as a product of X with this A1, and which is cohomologically smooth by base change. And so yeah, let me just finish by saying that for those who know what they are, that all Banach-Kolmé spaces are cohomologically smooth. I mean, all positive. Okay. Yeah, could be underlined not. OK, so. All connected Banach-Kolmé spaces. Effective, as they're called. OK, so more generally. All effective. So of course, you would really like to have a more geometric definition of what it means to be smooth. But the problem is that what we're working with is, in some sense, something like a topological space, and it's not a manifold. So if you had a map of manifolds, you would know what it means to be smooth, because you can look at tangent spaces. But if you just have a topological space, what does it mean for a map of topological spaces to be smooth? And so I'm unable to give a direct geometric definition of this. And so but so far, one can work around this just by working with this very abstract notion of cohomological smoothness that can then be verified in the examples you care about.
And the pro-etale map, is that?
The pro-etale map is not cohomologically smooth. So so another property of cohomological smooth maps is that there are some finiteness properties for their cohomology. So they automatically, if lower shriek preserves constructible sheaves. for some notion of constructibility. But in particular, if you had a pro-etale map, say over a geometric point, it might be something like a profinite set. But the cohomology of a profinite set is, of course, very big. So this is not allowed.
What? Can you repeat what you just said?
The question was whether pro-etale maps are smooth, cohomologically smooth, and they are not. And the essential reason is that you don't have finiteness of cohomology for them. So something like a profinite set mapping to a point is pro-etale. But the cohomology of the profinite set is, of course, very big. Because, say, the H0 is already very big. OK, there's no higher cohomology, but the H0 is really big. And so that's not allowed. Did I want to say anything else? No, OK, yeah.
Any questions? How about local acyclicity?
Local acyclicity, come tomorrow. I will talk about local acyclicity.
Okay.
Is there some general result saying that something is compactifiable?
Is there some general result saying something is compactifiable? No, but again, like in these procedures here where you were having some examples and you were like the same kind of reduction procedures that you were doing here, they also work for the compactifiable notion. So in practice, it can be checked. Yeah. Yeah.
Okay, next time, just speak again.